Good morning from WKYT News. I'm Bill Bryant, and we welcome you to Kentucky Newsmakers. It is a busy start to 2017 at Lexington City Hall. Mayor Jim Gray recently delivered his State of the Merged Government address. He pronounced the local economy healthy with low unemployment and strong home sales and values. He also announced a foundation to help the busy police department. The Urban County Government's Public Safety Commissioner has also said Lexington is not a sanctuary city for people who are in the country illegally, but he also explained the boundaries that are observed in determining legal status of those interacting with police. A city ordinance against panhandling was struck down this week by the state Supreme Court. How will the city now deal with that issue? Mayor Gray says the cost of moving and restoring the People's Bank building near Rupp Arena that was built in the 1960s is climbing too much. The city wants the money that it has put into the project back. The legislature busy passing some laws, and some will impact cities. We'll ask the mayor about that. As the spring season appears to be arriving early, we'll talk about efforts to fix the potholes and get the Athens of the West ready to show off in the warmer months to come. And Mayor Gray is talking about what's going to be happening in the future. It's his second term at City Hall. He hasn't said if he'll seek a third term. He may not answer that today, but we'll ask. Mayor Jim Gray joining us. Thanks for coming. We appreciate it.
Oh, it's always great to be with you, Bill.
Let's get right to this issue of the Kentucky Supreme Court ruling on panhandling this week. The justices said that free speech trumps the local ordinance. How will the city adjust?
Well, this goes back to the Supreme Court ruling of at least a couple of years ago, and free speech was the basis of that decision then, and the Kentucky Supreme Court followed that. Now, I don't always like a decision of the courts, but what this means is that the city cannot enforce its local ordinance on panhandling. And what we'll do now is we'll examine what we can do, and putting safety first. You know, safety of our citizens is a first priority. And I think then as the administration and as the council looks at perhaps changes or adjustments that can be made, what we want to do is make sure that those who are asking for help are safe and those who are willing to give help are safe.
So when there are matters of safety, such as people maybe standing in busy intersections the entrance to businesses or government offices, can there be a different approach at that time?
Well, you know, that's what this decision really spoke to, was that free speech allows someone to stand and put a sign up, but we're going to examine how that is, perhaps how that, then that decision, what we might be able to do as a result of that decision, with a focus on safety first.
Mayor, where do the complaints about panhandling generally come from in the community?
Well, you get it a lot in the downtown area, but we've also gotten it in the suburbs. We've gotten it at our shopping centers. So you're really not restricted to where these complaints come from.
Is the city effectively dealing with the homelessness, with the poverty issue? I mean, does this speak to a larger issue?
Well, Lexington provides a lot of services, and a lot of services for the homeless. We've got an office in the city, the Office of Homelessness Prevention and Intervention, and $750,000 a year committed to that. What we know is that Lexington provides these services, and so Lexington then because we provide these services, some of our neighboring counties don't. And we're going then to have to, we have the challenge of addressing these needs. We have lots of services offered. Now, what we are doing is we're also have included $2 million a year for affordable housing, which is more than any city in the state's done. And that's leveraged more than $24 million in private investment. So we're working on a number of fronts to deal with the homeless. And our veterans homelessness bill is virtually zero today.
Can you, under this ruling, as you understand it, and I get it that you're still trying to get some positive, solid answers here about what can happen, but can the police, while not armed with this law anymore, this local ordinance, can they nevertheless at least make suggestions about how people might be disrupting traffic or the flow of people in an area?
What the police can do is intervene in situations where someone is clearly in danger or clearly maybe not have full capacity. And then the police can intervene.
So you'll study this going forward?
Well, that's exactly
what we're going to do. Is there a possibility of another ordinance that might be less onerous?
There's always a possibility. There's always a possibility of an ordinance because we know that these issues, Bill, have to be continuously addressed. And that's what government tries to do. And then we've got the balance. We've got the balance of authority and power. And that's where the courts come in. And so what I might not like, the courts have decided that we can't enforce this ordinance that we had on our books.
An issue that is a little similar is this adjusting of the curfew in Lexington. Right. You're actually allowing youngsters to be out later in some cases. How did that discussion go?
Well, we've got an ordinance on the book today that's almost 20 years old. And so examining that and bringing it up to date in a way that will help parents and also allow the police to do their work. Where the ordinance would actually work for the police. Because I think, our police, we're now at an authorized strength more than we've ever had, 600. But police are expected to do a lot of things, community policing, for example. And this comes under community policing. So I think going forward, what the administration, the council will do is examine this curfew and perhaps make some changes to it that will update it.
But the talk right now is of allowing it to go later.
Well, there's some talk about that. Yeah, there is some talk about allowing it to go a little bit later.
Let's talk about your State of the Merge government address. You seem very confident about the economy in the Bluegrass right now.
Yeah, we've gone from almost 8% unemployment to 2.8%. So that's actually better than full employment. Full employment is often described between 4% and 5%. So we've got a very robust economy in Fayette County, in Lexington and Fayette County. And actually, to some extent, that can challenge us because when we have full employment, then you, in order to increase, for example, the needs of a government are always increasing. The expectations of citizens, I've learned in this job, are always increasing. And we've got to focus on continuous improvement, waking up every day thinking, how are we going to improve today what we did yesterday? And that means, how are we going to encourage an economy that gives people opportunity, gives people and job opportunities? This is what I've focused on all my life, and that's why I said when I became mayor that the three goals that I had were creating jobs, running government efficiently, and building a great American city. So even as we are in good shape, we've still got to work toward creating better job opportunities for our people.
As you point out, Lexington's economy has some very diverse sectors: healthcare, education, retail, entertainment, others. What areas?
Agriculture, manufacturing.
Right. What areas have the most upside in your opinion? What has the potential for growth in the future?
Well, Lexington is becoming a hub for tourism. Now, that doesn't always bring new jobs, but it brings a visibility to a city and in many respects a viability to a city and the opportunity to attract new businesses. Now, what I see as an opportunity today is leveraging the University of Kentucky, BCTC, Transylvania, all of our educational assets in Lexington, leveraging those, especially the research capabilities at the university, and encouraging higher technology companies. We have a number of those. Our jobs fund at the city, where we've invested more than $1 million in encouraging, through incentives and through loans, encouraging medium startup companies, startup medium-sized small businesses to grow. And some of those are doing extremely well today, employed more than 100 people already through the jobs fund and creating a significant new economic opportunity.
What can the government do to make those opportunities better? What can the city government do?
Well, what the city government has done is encourage is something very unique, and that's our jobs fund. I just mentioned it, where the city has actually invested in incentives, just like the state has done in a similar way. The state's done, and we've encouraged a number of new businesses to locate here in Lexington. And some of these have been startup businesses that are doing quite well. There's one startup called Make Time that's now employing more than 60 people. And these are high paying jobs, and that's the kind of jobs that people want.
You announced a foundation for the police department. Yes. At your State of the Merge government address. What does that money go for?
Well, this was initiated by a local businessman and leader, Craig Turner, and a partner of Craig's, Garen Denning. And they pulled together this foundation, which would help police in hardship situations. Some of our police officers may get in a hardship situation, and it would help them when those conditions or those occasions arise. But it would also provide an opportunity for the police to do things that they might not otherwise be able to do. And I think of some community initiatives, for example, that police would find the need for. They don't have the resources perhaps today for, and this would provide those resources.
There's always a concern when people are donating to a fund that goes into law enforcement of a possibility of some sort of favoritism. You have a governance against that, some way that to keep that in check?
Well, that's a good point. And because this foundation is just emerging, they're going to be developing policies, procedures that would ensure these sorts of, that would prevent and ensure this sort of thing from occurring.
All right, Lexington Mayor Jim Gray is our guest. Is Lexington a sanctuary city? He says no. What is the stance on immigrants in the city? We'll have that, a whole lot more. We'll ask him about his future on WKYT's Kentucky Newsmakers. Welcome back into WKYT's Kentucky Newsmakers. It's good to have you with us. Lexington Mayor Jim Gray is joining us this morning. Mayor, Lexington's Public Safety Commissioner Ronnie Bastin makes it clear Lexington is not a sanctuary city for illegal immigrants, but he also indicates that law enforcement doesn't do things that would potentially prevent crimes from being reported. How does that all balance?
Well, we are not a sanctuary city.
Yes.
Now, what is a sanctuary city is what really needs to be understood, I think, Bill. And sanctuary cities are cities or jurisdictions that pass ordinances, local ordinances, which prevent law enforcement officials from arresting anyone on the basis of whether or not they would be undocumented. All right? So Lexington is not a jurisdiction that has done that. So what this translates into is that when ICE, for example, our immigration authorities, they ask our corrections facility, our jail, if they find that they may suspect that someone is illegally in the country, and then they have the authority to enter our facilities. But the Lexington police, as an example, don't go out searching, right? And that's what Commissioner Bastin, I believe, was referring to.
And he said the violations are evaluated based on the facts and,
yes,
and the actions of individuals, not on the immigration status. Are there concerns of the possibility of losing federal funding when a city does classify itself in that way?
Well, that's one of the challenges or one of the exposures or risks, yes.
A member of the Lexington City Council, Sasha Love, is facing theft and forgery charges. She has was served a summons and has since attended council meetings. What is the process for handling that situation if she's convicted?
Well, Bill, that's an ongoing investigation, and I'm really not able to comment on that today.
But she, at this time, can continue to attend.
Yes, she can continue.
Meetings.
Right.
Yeah,
yeah.
You know that
yes, right.
For a fact. All right. The former council member Dr. David Stevens recently died. I know you wanted to say something about him, a champion for the smoking ban in workplaces. And also, he was a progressive on a lot of issues in the community, wasn't he?
A lot of issues, yeah. David was, David was a good and generous man, and he was an example of a gentleman in so many respects. He worked collaboratively with folks whenever he had a new initiative. He was so active with the local blood bank. He was so active, and he was so instrumental in the smoking ban. But there were other issues that he took on, and he was never afraid to take on a tough issue. And he was just a public servant. I say he was a citizen soldier in just every way.
When he stepped out on the smoking ban as a physician and a surgeon, Did it have extra credibility?
Oh, I think you're absolutely right. It had enormous, he brought enormous credibility to the, to that position, to that issue. He brought so much credibility because he was a physician. And a surgeon, yes.
And former Lexington Vice Mayor James Todd also died at the age of 87. That was this week. And he served under Mayors Jim Amato and Scotty Basler. That was before your time in city government. But certainly it hasn't been that long that the urban county government has been together. Right. And so everybody knows everybody.
Yeah. And Vice Mayor Todd was instrumental in shifting the vice mayor's role from one appointed within the council, among the council, to one that was a function of the public vote, and which is the way I was elected to vice mayor.
To hand that over really to the people.
Yeah, shifted it. He was behind that.
Before that, they fought it out.
Inside the council, right.
Do you reach out to former mayors and other elected officials for advice?
I used to, Foster Pettit, who passed away a couple of years ago. Foster was a real touchstone for me. And I've often called Scotty Basler and Pam Miller routinely, Isabel Yates, a former vice mayor. These are wonderful people, and they had so much experience. And in answer to that question, yes, I absolutely do.
What are you watching in Frankfort right now? We know that, for one thing, cities are making a push for additional funding for roads. A lot of that has been more heavily shifted, gone to rural areas in the past. The population shifts, the traffic patterns have moved to the cities.
Right.
Do you favor, I think the Kentucky League of Cities is pushing legislation that would change that formula some.
Right, and I support the league's formula and their initiative in this respect, because what we find is in the city, we are spending more and more on road repair, on paving, and that really straps us. Our budget historically has not had to spend so much in local paving, local roads, and that number has had to expand. So yes, I would support it. And other issues that are in the state today, the pension reform is a very big issue. We reformed our pension, as you may recall, Bill, 5 years ago, our police and fire pension, and it was described as the most effective pension reform in the country, actually, at the time. And taking a $300 million unfunded liability down to less than $100 million today. We've got this similar problem, except in a more severe way, with the county employee pension system and the Kentucky employee pension system. And those really need to be fixed, because our employees that are outside of police and fire are covered under the CERS. And so fixing that is a real priority. And I'm glad the governor has stepped up and talked about it so vigorously.
You have been fortunate to avoid a tough winter this year. There have been years that you have come in here before daylight and told us basically what crews were doing to try to remove snow and so forth. It looks like we have escaped that. Does that save the city considerable money?
Well, knock on wood.
Right.
You know, I'll talk to Albert Miller, our superintendent of streets and roads, as I refer to him. He's the director of streets and roads. But yeah, we've got we're saving perhaps as much as six figures, high six figures this year, maybe as much as $750,000 in salt, but that doesn't include the other costs that we have, of course, that occur in the course of a winter.
So you get to shift your attention now to maybe the warm months ahead. We'll see.
Yeah. Well, we've still got a few. I remember big snows, and you do too, when we were growing up in March.
Right. And we had one here the last couple of years. But yeah. What kinds of things do you do in spring? Fixing the potholes would seem to be a high priority on the roads.
It comes right out. We've got a couple of pothole crews that are out and routinely. And yes, after. And of course, we may not have as many potholes. Fortunately, mm-hmm. this year, because the salt has an effect in encouraging the salt in the snow, encouraging potholes. So we may have fewer, we'll probably arguably have fewer. And our streets and road crews I have people tell me routinely, actually across the state, that they love coming to Lexington because it's such a beautiful city. And it really is a garden city. And so, you know, having our crews that are taking care of the way the city looks is so important as well.
Parks and Recreation may be looking to get busy early on, and there are some new things going on there.
Yep.
I don't know what these things are called. Spray grounds?
Spray grounds.
It sounds fun.
Bill, it is.
What are
and,
those?
These are, you know, almost like fountains, and the kids love them. And finding that they almost enjoy them better than pools today. And we've got spray grounds at Masterson and Jacobson, and we're looking at them at a couple of other parks, including Douglas, coming up next year.
They just run through them kind of thing?
Running through them, right, enjoying them, yep.
All right.
And parents enjoy it as well. Well, parents enjoy the kids being there,
sure.
is what I'm saying.
Sure.
Yeah.
All right. I want to ask you about the historic courthouse and some other things. We'll be back with Lexington Mayor Jim Gray, our remaining moments with him on Kentucky Newsmakers in a moment. Welcome back. Great to have you with us here on WKYT for Kentucky Newsmakers as we continue our visit with Lexington Mayor Jim Gray, and it's good to have you along. The historic courthouse is coming right along, as you say. You're very excited about that project. I know that it's an iconic building in town that could have been torn down.
There was conversation
right.
about taking it down. You know, this was an extraordinary example of Richardsonian architecture, late 1800s. And, you know, this is an example. It's all across the state. New courthouses were built, just like our new courthouses 20 years ago, but nothing was planned for dealing with the old courthouse. And this is a really, it's an inspiring structure. It's going to be remarkable. Visitor center for our city is going to be there, so visitors entering the city are going to see exhibits and going to see the history of the city. And you know, for example, there's some conversation going on that our side of the Bourbon Tour, the Bourbon Trail, would start at the old courthouse. So there are lots of opportunities. There's going to be event space on the top floor. The Breeders' Cup is locating its offices there. And you'll be able to see the original rotunda, which is just inspiring as can be. I think I've said extraordinary and remarkable too many times already. But yeah, I'm excited about it. I'm in the building business, and when you see a building that was designed first and then built so well, and that represents, you use the language iconic, you know, there's so many. The Chamber of Commerce uses it on its website as the touchstone image, you know, and so many others do. So I'm, yes, shorthand, yes, very excited about
it. As that has gone so well, something that has not worked out so well is this, the People's Bank building over there that you wanted to preserve. We're trying to get it moved and so forth, but now you say the city wants its money back, what it's put into this.
Well, people that originally wanted to do the project, very well intended, and really worked vigorously on it. And the city, yes, did make a commitment. But the costs have just increased to a level that it's not an achievable project today. And the city ending its involvement means that we will get a substantial amount of our funds back.
So, I mean, that's a done deal, as you...
The city's position is that, yes, that we have ended our involvement in the project, right.
You were eligible for a third term in 2018. Some others who are potentially interested in being mayor, if you decide to leave that job, have told me that they are hoping to hear your plans at some point. There's a congressional race in the 6th District in 2018. The Democratic Congressional Campaign Committee has put the Republican Congressman Andy Barr on a target list. Are they talking with you?
I've had no conversations with anyone in Washington about the 6th District seat. I will tell you, Bill, that I say routinely that even on a bad day, I've got a great job. Now, I also go on to say that if you have a deep need to be loved, don't run for mayor. You know, try something else. It's a challenging role, but I've enjoyed it enormously.
You also said you enjoyed, though, that U.S. Senate race that you lost to Republican Rand Paul, that statewide run, and you said you enjoyed that and that it invigorated you. There have been those who have mentioned you potentially making a statewide run in 2019. That would be difficult, wouldn't it, if you had just run a mayor's race, been reelected, and 3 months later you put your name on the ballot?
That would be challenging. That would be a challenge, yes, sir. Well, let me say, I am happy where I am. This is a wonderfully challenging role, and we have a great city. And focusing on Lexington is something that I am today committed to.
Would you say it is most likely you will seek re-election in 2018?
I'm going to share with you, I will commit to you, Bill, that you will get a call from me just as soon as that decision and as we were making them.
All right. Mayor Gray, thanks for coming.
Appreciate it. Thank you, Bill.
All right. Thank you for joining us for this edition of Kentucky Newsmakers from WKYT. We'll be seeing you bright and early this week on WKYT This Morning. We begin at 4:30 for some political updates and observations about what's going on in Kentucky. Follow me on Twitter at KY Newsmakers, and you make it a good week ahead.